Hello, everyone. As part of the NASH education program, we'll be discussing the care available for NASH patients. Professor Castera will be with us for the entire program. We'll be off to New York to hear from a patient who was diagnosed with NASH a year ago. After that, we'll be interviewing a member of a scientific organization to understand how patient care can be improved. Professor Castera, hello.
Hello.
Thank you for joining us to talk about NASH patient management. So far, we are aware that there are no treatments approved by the authorities like the FDA, and so for now, there is nothing available on the market. So in the meantime, what can doctors prescribe to patients who've NASH?
So even though there is no approved treatment so far, still lifestyle modifications are important. Physical exercise, ideally every day, even though it's not maybe a reachable goal in most patients, but also diet, and diet matters.
Could you give us an example?
Ideally, you should be aiming at reducing your weight, let's say by 10%. If you reduce your weight by 10%, then you will have an improvement in the disease.
We talk about reducing one's weight by 10%, but is it that easy?
No, it's not that easy. If it was easy, everyone would be able to do it. I mean, and this is probably much more difficult than taking a drug.
So how complex it is?
It's complex because this deals with many aspects. And most of these people are usually above 40 or 50. So it's very difficult to change your lifestyle when all your life long you've been having a certain lifestyle.
Because we know that there is a certain craving for sugar, for fat, for salt, etc.
Yeah, and there's a lot of pressure in your everyday social life.
So I guess it must be quite difficult to convince patients to change your lifestyle, isn't it?
It is even more difficult because, I mean, you go to the dentist when you have a toothache. Otherwise, you don't go. I don't go, personally. But to convince people that they might have a severe liver disease in the absence of symptoms is very challenging. And this is a general challenge for all liver disease, not only for NAFLD. You can have cirrhosis with no symptom. So this is why it's difficult to convince people to change their lifestyle. We know as doctors that it will have an impact, but patients are not always convinced first that they have a liver disease, then they need to take measure and to start a diet to fight against this.
So it's not necessarily a question of willpower?
No, I don't think it's a question of willpower. It's much more complex than that.
What happens if, despite all my attempts as an overweight person to change my diet or my lifestyle, the disease continues to grow and the patient sees that, you know, the stages keep developing?
So you're at risk of developing complications such as cirrhosis or liver decompensation, including liver cancer. And in the end, you might come up and to be transplanted.
Okay.
To change your liver. Fortunately, this is just a minority of NAFLD patients, given the global epidemic, but still, in centers like ours, we have patients transplanted for NAFLD every year.
Okay. So in New York City, we met Marcella. She was diagnosed with a fatty liver years ago, and now she is NASH. Let's listen to her story.
We're in New York. Marcella is 41 years old.
I had been told that I had a fatty liver about 15 years ago, and in the education of that with my primary care at that time, he emphasized that if I didn't have a healthy lifestyle and change my diet, that I would get diabetes. So the emphasis was on diabetes. And so I always felt that as long as I was not reaching to that point of diabetes, that I was fine.
Her life changed a year ago when she was diagnosed with stage 3 NASH, an advanced stage that can quickly progress to cirrhosis or liver cancer.
I was scared. I'm at a stage 3, so hearing stage 3, that you have stage 3 anything, is shocking. You're asking a lot of questions. I certainly did my own research and really thought about it, what it meant for me and my family. And so I was just in shock. I was told that I would have 3 to 5 years to live without a liver transplant.
Marcella has been trying to reverse the evolution of the disease. She has lost a lot of weight, but it hasn't been easy.
That's one of the things that I focused on was the nutrition aspect of it, to rewrite what I had learned on how to eat, because obviously what I had done before wasn't working. And so on my journey to this was ultimately, you know, to lose weight and to change my lifestyle. The toughest so far has definitely been the lack of information that's out there, struggling to find out, you know, what the lifestyle changes, what things should I eat for the benefit of my liver, versus just trying to lose weight. But definitely I'm hopeful. I think the medical community overall, researchers are amazing. You know, their abilities to find cures and, you know, being able to find different medications, it's just phenomenal. So I think that ultimately there will be something that would help people.
So, Professor Castera, there are no drugs approved today for NASH, but what can we expect in the future?
So I have good news. The future is quite bright. Even though we don't have drugs currently, there are many ongoing trials, so-called phase 3 trials, so meaning for people who are not familiar, that is the final phase before drugs get approved and will arrive on the market. So we have at least 4 ongoing phase 3 trials. And very likely, after 2020, we might see some new drugs on the market. So this is very good news.
So you mean that within 2 years, we should actually see some drugs appear on the market, right?
2 to 4 years, I would say.
2 to 4 years to treat NASH.
Absolutely.
At which point I will be able to cure myself, should I actually be affected by the disease?
So far, most of the studies are targeting the patients, the more severe. And this is no surprise because, of course, given the magnitude of the epidemic, 1 out of 5 people in the general population, you have to target the most severe patient.
Okay, I see. In your department, do you offer a cross-disciplinary approach?
So this is not yet, but this is what we are now implementing. And this is done with the diabetologists. Because, as you know, diabetes is very common in the population. And just to let you know that about 70 to 80% of type 2 diabetic patients have NAFLD.
Okay, so we visited a hospital in Nantes, France, that's also offering that type of patient care, cross-disciplinary approach. Over there, we'll meet Professor Cariou, a member of the NASH Education Program Scientific Committee.
At Nantes University Hospital in France, a specific and coordinated healthcare journey brings together all disciplines to treat patients with NASH, like Bérangère, diagnosed 10 years ago.
Vers l'âge de 40 ans, je me suis sentie très fatiguée. Je voyais que lorsque je m'achetais des vêtements, j'achetais une taille supplémentaire. Un jour, je suis allée chez ma coiffeuse et la tête m'a tournée. Elle a appelé les pompiers. Je suis arrivée dans le service du monsieur Cariou. On a découvert que j'avais une stéatose.
Every 6 months, Bérangère sees her endocrinologist and diabetologist, Professor Cariou. It's he who coordinates across various hospitals in Nantes this multidisciplinary care for patients with NASH.
Pour cette patiente, la porte d'entrée a été le service d'endocrinologie. Elle est venue dans le service en vue de discuter une chirurgie de l'obésité, donc une chirurgie bariatrique, et elle a eu un bilan qu'on a adressé donc au docteur Gournay, pathologue, qui lui a été plus loin. Et là, il y a eu une biopsie qui a été faite chez cette patiente qui a authentifié qu'elle avait vraiment une NASH, et donc ce qui nous a conforté dans l'option d'aller lui proposer une chirurgie bariatrique, à la fois pour améliorer son obésité, ce qui était son souhait à elle, son diabète, et également sa NASH.
This procedure could benefit a number of patients, but few of them are eligible for various reasons. Bérangère was able to benefit from this operation. Today, she's still being followed by the digestive surgeon who 8 years ago gave her a gastric bypass to enable her to lose weight.
Multidisciplinaire, sans mes collègues spécialistes médicaux, que ce soit l'hépatologue, l'endocrinologue nutritionniste, le médecin traitant qui a un rôle important, le suivi diététique par la diététicienne et le chirurgien. En fait, sans tous ces acteurs-là, en fait, ça ne fonctionnerait pas.
Bérangère also sees her hepatologist, who regularly monitors the state of her liver.
Je vois Bérangère toutes les ans pour m'assurer que le degré de fibrose ne progresse pas, ce qui est le cas chez elle, grâce au contrôle du poids induit par la chirurgie bariatrique. L'approche pluridisciplinaire, elle a tout son sens, parce qu'en fait, ce sont des patients qui sont au carrefour de plusieurs maladies cardiovasculaires, mais aussi hépatiques, et c'est important que tous les médecins qui sont impliqués dans la prise en charge de ces conséquences s'entendent sur les objectifs à atteindre chez un patient. Et dans le cas de Bérangère, on avait des objectifs à la fois métaboliques qui étaient très importants, c'est-à-dire contrôler le diabète, contrôler l'hypertension artérielle, et de mon côté, il fallait effectivement améliorer l'état du foie, et c'est vraiment la concertation entre les deux disciplines qui a permis de proposer à Bérangère le traitement le plus adapté.
And to make sure she doesn't fall back into poor dietary habits, Bérangère continues to see her dietitian.
On est tous centrés autour du patient, chacun sa spécialité, on est très complémentaires et on communique énormément via un logiciel que l'on partage à l'hôpital. Donc on a accès à tous les comptes rendus, tous les bilans. Donc ça donne de la cohérence dans le parcours de soins, le patient se retrouve mieux aussi dans le parcours de soins parce qu'on parle le même langage et on est en mesure de rebondir aussi sur une consultation qui a eu lieu à un autre endroit avec un autre spécialiste pour améliorer les pratiques des patients et les amener vers une meilleure santé.
Ben, je sens qu'autour de moi, il y a un cercle. Moi, je suis au milieu et ils se concertent et ça marche comme ça.
A multidisciplinary approach structured notably around hepatology and diabetology thus appears to have many virtues, especially as it allows patients to better understand their illness thanks to wider-reaching and more complete information.
So, Professor Castera, do you believe that better information for patients means better care eventually?
Absolutely. I think information is critical. Awareness is low, not only among our colleagues, but also among patients. Most patients with this disease do not know they have this disease. So this is why we need to raise the awareness.
And I guess one central figure is the general practitioner, the family doctors, as we say, do you think that they have sufficient level of education and information regarding NASH today?
I mean, GPs, general practitioners, are a critical and central issue in the management of this disease. You also have to be to take into account to be aware that they have a lot of requests. They have to deal with hypertension, with obesity, with diabetes. So liver is not really high on their priority list. And we need also to increase because they are really the first step. When you go to the doctor, you go to see your GP.
So the doctors need to be educated better on this.
Absolutely.
Issue. Okay.
Absolutely.
Providing sound information and education is also the task of patients' organization. One of the most prominent one in the US is ALF, the American Liver Foundation. Its members are very active. Let's take a look at what they do to understand why they decided to support the first International NASH Day.
Tom Nealon is the CEO of the American Liver Foundation. It is a liver patient association which aims to raise awareness about liver diseases and NASH.
Both NAFLD and NASH, people have no idea what these letters mean, let alone how widespread and impactful it is in the lives of just ordinary people. Nobody discusses liver disease, and most people, even those who've had liver disease and are cured or are managing it, never mention it because the mere mention of the word liver, you know, brings up those stigma images.
Through events, conferences, and their website, the association also helps patients get information about the disease.
I see certainly in the NASH area that will be a growing area of focus because I think almost any medical professional you talk to says that in relatively short order, NASH will probably become one of the, if not the major reason for liver transplantation and unfortunately for deaths due to liver disease. I think the first International NASH Day is a monumental event because it will bring long overdue attention to the importance of people being aware of liver health, liver wellness, and hopefully it will be an impetus for them to examine more closely their own lifestyles and make sure they consult with a professional to get any and all treatments that might be necessary.
Professor Castera will now take one question from a web user. Here is one. I have NASH and I'm type 2 diabetic. Can I hope to be cured by modifying my diet?
I'm not sure. Diet is part, of course, of the management, but it really depends on the stage. So staging the disease is also critical. In other words, to know whether you're close to cirrhosis or you have cirrhosis, which is a different story because you have to manage the cause, the underlying cause, mm-hmm. the NAFLD, but also the cirrhosis and the monitoring.
So diet won't do much?
So diet at this stage, there might be a point of no return where diet will not be enough and where drugs will be also important. As of now, we have a great expectation regarding the drugs that are currently evaluated in phase 3 trials. I would be cautious with the term cured, because in a chronic disease, especially in diabetes, you do not cure.
How can you,
you
treat?
You monitor, you treat, you control, but you don't cure. It's not like viral hepatitis, so this is important.
Changing one's lifestyle and drug treatment.
Absolutely.
Well, thank you very much for having been with us today. And if you want to have some further information, you can always go to our website and watch the program on the first International NASH Day.